All right. Okay. Apparently, my PhD students are not as polite as the medical students. Okay. All right. Spirochetes and Neisseria. Okay, that's what we're going to cover next. Now, I'm just being mean. I like to be mean now and again. It makes my day feel better, you know. So. All right, spirochetes and Neisseria. We're going to again cover keywords. All right, the in red, now we're talking about here two very different groups of organisms, first of all. The spirochetes and the Neisseria, as in terms of genetically and any other way you want to look at them, have nothing to do with each other. The reason we're covering the spirochetes and the Neisseria together is because the two of the major diseases that are two of the three major sexually transmitted diseases, the third being mediated by chlamydia, are syphilis caused by Treponema pallidum, and gonorrhea caused by Neisseria gonorrhoeae. So we're covering and we're going to talk a lot of what we're going to talk about today is syphilis and gonorrhea. So that's why we're covering this together. But at the same time, there are actually there's another major disease caused by the organisms related to the syphilis organism, the spirochete, which causes Lyme disease. And among the Neisseria, the second major cause of meningitis is caused by one of the Neisseria. Okay, so that's the rationale for why we're covering these organisms together. So the red, the general term is spirochete. This whole thing here is basically referring to Treponema pallidum. Well, actually, I should have put that in a different color, but whatever. Treponema pallidum down, that's syphilis we're talking about. All of this is spirochetes. We're still talking about spirochetes when we get to Borrelia, and we're talking about two diseases there. The big one is Lyme disease. The more historically important one is relapsing fever. And then maybe it's a good thing, it's a color you can hardly see. Then we have leptospirosis, which is hardly seen in this country. These are different genera within the spirochetes. There are three different genera we're talking about: Treponema, Borrelia, and Leptospira. They're three separate genera within the general term for these things is spirochetes, because they're spiral-shaped organisms. Then down here are the Neisseria, which includes two different organisms: Neisseria gonorrhoeae, which is gonorrhea, and Neisseria meningitidis, which is meningitis we're talking about. Okay? So that's the rationale for what we're doing. So we will compare syphilis and gonorrhea as we go along. I will put up some nasty pictures just to ruin your day. You know, some of you have seen them already. Okay, syphilis and gonorrhea. Okay, so first we're starting with the spirochetes, which are the Treponema, the Borrelia, and the Leptospira. These are all three genera can cause human disease. The spirochetes are gram-negative, long, thin, helical, and motile. Most of the time, I don't make a big deal about motility, but this is an issue when you in a diagnosis in the clinical microbiology laboratory, as we'll see in a second. I mentioned in an earlier lecture about flagella, and I mentioned axial filaments. These are the organisms that have the axial filaments, which is a type of flagella. The plural is flagella. The singular is flagellum. These organisms have axial filaments, which are a type of flagellum. So they're involved in locomotion. In this instance, it's running parallel. It's in between the peptidoglycan layer and the outer membrane. It's not sticking out from the cell. When we talk about flagella and pili, we always talk about them extending out from the cell. And I showed you some pictures of that as we've gone along. And here's an example of some Treponema. So here's Treponema pallidum. Growing in this case in an infected rabbit testis. You might say to yourself, why on earth is it growing in an infected rabbit testis? Because the point is, these organisms can't be grown in the laboratory. They don't grow. And if you want to study them, you have to study them in an animal model or tissue culture, because they don't grow in lifeless media. They need cells to grow. Treponema pallidum transmission is genital to genital. It can also affect a child while growing in the uterus or during during birth. I don't know why I felt, I did add in the handout the statement the day that everybody makes, I thought maybe it was about time I made it, that you don't get this disease by sitting on a toilet seat. Okay, I think everybody knows that. So I've not put it in the PowerPoint presentation, but I did reluctantly, finally this year for the first time, put it in my handout, okay, because everybody knows that, but I think maybe I should emphasize it. This is transmitted, this is a genital infection, sex, that's how you get, or in the case of, you know, say, you know, a fetus or a neonate, that's the other way you can get it. And that refers, you can get this, this refers also to gonorrhea as well. No toilet seats. Okay. Syphilis is a chronic disease which is slowly progressive. And that means exactly what it says. If you don't treat somebody with syphilis, this disease could go on for years before it eventually would probably not so much kill you. It would probably, what would happen is you'll get neurosyphilis and basically you'll lose your brain function. How do we know this? Well, unfortunately, we know this because, and I've forgotten the name of that too, but there was a famous experiment that was done, which these people, I don't know if they ended up in jail or not, but there was a group of people who didn't, where there was a group of African Americans in this country, who some of whom were treated and some of whom weren't for decades. And it was actually followed in this situation. And finally, it was recognized, maybe this wasn't such a good thing to do. I thought we recognized that in Nazi Germany. But anyway, so we do have some. So there has been a study done of this in this country, and so we know it's a very slowly progressive disease. But if people are treated, there's no reason that this should ever get to the tertiary stage, because there are considered to be three stages in syphilis. The first, the primary lesion, is referred to as a chancre, as opposed to chancroid, which you see in Haemophilus ducreyi, which I don't know if my wife, I think my wife should be covering that, but I don't make that promise. But anyway, but this is referred to as a chancre as opposed to chancroid. A chancre is a hard thing. Chancroid is often more soft. But anyway, that's a chancre. That's a pretty big chancre, so it's pretty obvious. It's not always that obvious, of course. It's an area of ulceration and inflammation, and there are often many organisms present in that chancre. So you can take a little drop of it, and you can put it on a slide. And this is where the motility comes into it, because we've already said how unusual these organisms are morphologically in terms of their being spiral-shaped organisms. But being the fact they're motile, if you put a little drop of these organisms on a slide in the appropriate way, we'll get to that in a second, you can actually see these things swimming around like little snakes. So the motility is an issue, okay? And that's why one of the reasons we make a big deal about motility in this situation. Now, the disease then progresses as a secondary infection. You know, that can be weeks later. Still weeks we're talking about here, not months, not years. Because it doesn't have to be, because it shouldn't get beyond this point. Okay, so the systemic spread, flu-like symptoms, and the skin particularly can be affected. There are many organisms to be present in these lesions. It's highly infectious. Now, the point is that in secondary, we're saying weeks later, you know, and an immune response, you know, takes generally, it can take a couple of weeks as a minimum, or it can take as long as 6 weeks or even longer. But weeks are the sort of time period we're talking about to develop an immune response. And this is a situation where we have an organism that doesn't grow in the laboratory. So we've got to have other ways to make a laboratory-based diagnosis in addition to the clinical observations of the physician. And so these issues of time frame come into play in making a decision as to what is appropriate when. And we'll get through the stages, and then we'll come back to diagnosis again. Tertiary syphilis occurs. It can take years to develop. That's how, when I say slowly progressive, that's exactly what I mean. It really does take a long time. And you should never see a case of tertiary syphilis. I mean, it just shouldn't, basically just shouldn't happen. But unfortunately, it did happen. It was observed, and it's only about, I don't know, 30, 40 years ago this sort of thing stopped, study I talked about from that time period. Tertiary syphilis takes several years. It's rare, affects the skin, but it particularly affects the central nervous system. This will refer to secondary syphilis. It's particularly a delayed hypersensitivity reaction. These organisms are growing in cells. They're typical intracellular pathogens. Few organisms, because the immune response does control this disease. So that's why it goes on for so long, because the immune response is doing a pretty good job of controlling the disease. But presumably, the delayed hypersensitivity is contributing to the disease itself. Okay, so now we get back to diagnosis, basically understanding these different features as we go from primary to secondary to tertiary syphilis. Again, it is not culturable. The dark field microscopy is primarily used in microbiology for this particular situation. As I said, these are actively motile organisms. They are very thin. They're long and thin and spiral. If you just looked at them under a regular microscope or you did a Gram stain, you probably wouldn't see them. So in this instance, what's done is with dark field microscopy, what happens is the way the microscope's organized, and there's a little more information in the handout, but the bottom line is that you see the organisms as brightly lit against the dark backdrop. Okay, the light shines at an angle on the organisms and it's reflected into the lens of the microscope. When you see, of course, in conventional light microscopy, the light shines straight through, and you wouldn't see these organisms with conventional light microscopy. It's specifically dark field microscopy that's carried out. Okay, that's particularly for primary syphilis, where the organism is in the chancre, where you can take a swab, you can take a little bit of fluid, and you can take a look. The human eye is not that great at looking down microscopes, you know, and so I tried to find a picture of this, and amazingly enough, I couldn't find the picture on the net, but never, you know, Google has fouled me, you know, but anyway. Fluorescence microscopy, a lot of times as an alternative, you can take an antibody against these treponemes, labeled directly with fluorescence, and with this fluorescent labeled antibody, you can see these organisms as a bright green fluorescence under a fluorescent microscope. And it's easier to see fluorescence than it is to see, you know, in dark field microscopy. So that's used as an alternative sometimes. More complicated because you have to actually stain the things as opposed to just looking and just taking a sample and just taking a look. But it's an alternative. Now, as I mentioned, secondary syphilis, we're talking about several weeks after the initial. You've missed it, basically, is what it comes down to. The chancre, you may have not seen this, and particularly in women, this is the case, because of anatomical reasons, the chancres can be hidden, right? So it might not be as big as the one that I showed you. And it may go away sometimes, you know, after the initial infection, it may just heal itself up. So this could be missed. So you've got a situation now where the patient's missed it, or you've missed it, or whatever. And you're now in a situation of weeks, hopefully not months later. There's been an opportunity now for the immune response to develop. Now, there are two types of antibodies that are used, and this is an example of serology. And I stress again, I don't want anybody to be confused in this room between the difference between detecting an antigen and detecting an antibody. Okay, if you take an antibody and you throw it on some back, you're saying it with that, that was a, this was a, this is where we're using the, sorry. This is where we're using an antibody to detect the antigen in the bacteria. That's not serology, okay? Just because we're using antibodies doesn't make it serology. That's where we're looking at the bacterial antigen. Serology is where you look in the patient, you take a patient, usually a serum sample, and you look and see if there's any antibodies that are present in the patient's serum that have developed because they've been exposed to the organism during the infectious process. There are two types of serological tests that one can use. First of all, screening methods. These organisms grow, they do a lot of damage to the cells in which they're growing. And cardiolipin is a common lipid that is found in human cells, cell membranes. It's not that the organism makes cardiolipin. It's that the presumably what seems to happen is these organisms do enough damage. And remember, again, that all bacteria are natural adjuvants. They naturally stimulate the immune system because lipopolysaccharide and peptidoglycan are both adjuvants that stimulate the immune response. So these organisms stimulate an immune response against cardiolipin. This is an example of an autoimmune reaction. You know, as you, we use that term a lot, but we really a lot of times don't give specifics. This is an example of autoimmunity. So what's happened? It's not a reaction to the organism. It's not immunity against the organism. Now, that's why it's a screening method, because not surprisingly, there are other situated diseases, malaria is particularly one, where you can see antibodies develop against cardiolipin also, because it's not specifically a bacterial antigen, it's a host antigen that the test is detecting. So that's why it's considered a screening method, but it's cheap, because you can easily get hold of, you know, big hunks of meat and sort of extract lipids from them. And so it's very cheap to make cardiolipin-based tests. It's more expensive to have kits that detect treponemal antigens because these organisms are so, hard to deal with. More specific diagnosis, however, is done by using antibodies that recognize the treponemal antigens. Now, there are a host of different kits out there and tests out there with fancy names, and I've chosen not to burden you with them. But I would like you to think about when you, because you can work it out pretty easily, when you think about questions that may be on the boards, where it's set, where they talk about this, that's really what they're getting at. That's the whole crux of the question. If you've got that, regardless of whatever name is used, if you recognize what you're dealing either with antibodies against cardiolipin, or you're dealing with antibodies against the treponemal antigen, that's serology. That's the whole basis of what this is all about, okay? Not the whatever the name is. Okay, so that's done particularly in secondary and tertiary syphilis for obvious reasons, because if you've got a case of a primary syphilis, there may not have been enough time for an immune response to develop. Okay? So that's why we're particularly thinking about in primary syphilis, you're thinking about direct detection of the organism in a little drop of fluid that you might have scraped from a chancre, okay? As opposed to secondary or, as I worse, if you ever saw tertiary syphilis, mainly we're talking about secondary syphilis, this is what you're going to be doing. And yes, this is an example of autoimmunity. And even if it's spelt incorrectly, it's still autoimmunity. Okay, you can fix that on your own. How these creep in, I don't know. It doesn't matter how many times you prove stuff, it always goes wrong. Okay, this is an example of autoimmunity. There is no vaccine. There are something like 250,000 cases, new cases of syphilis a year, as opposed to some of the things we're talking about where, you know, it might be in the case of one of the things I'll talk about a little bit, less than 100 cases a year. Should there be a vaccine? Probably. But there isn't one. So it all comes down to, you know, time and effort and money, basically. Antibiotics, penicillin is still pretty effective. The classical penicillin is still pretty effective against syphilis. Okay, I'm not going to spend any real time on this except to say that there are some other diseases out there that occur in the third world called Bejel, Yaws, and Pinta, which at one point was said to be caused by Treponema pallidum. Now they're called, you know, sort of closely related species or variants or what have you. But these are caused by organisms that are very closely related to Treponema pallidum, okay? And they have slightly different clinical features. They're almost unseen in the US. But you may come across the terms Bejel, Yaws, or Pinta. And there's more details in Murray if you want to look it out. I haven't put up very much about this purposely in the handout. Okay. Now, an important disease. Now, that's syphilis, okay? Now, I'm going to get to gonorrhea in a little bit. We're going to deal with the spirochetes first, and then we'll get to gonorrhea. And when I get to gonorrhea, we'll refer back again to syphilis, because it's pretty obvious the differences between syphilis and gonorrhea. Okay. So we're dealing with the second most important spirochete disease now, Borrelia burgdorferi and Lyme disease. I remember very well when it wasn't that long ago, it was in the 80s, when Alan Steer, who's now at Yale, because I used to do rheumatology research, was going around the circles talking about this strange cluster of diseases he'd seen in Lyme, Connecticut. And people were saying, nah, this is ridiculous, which is the way usually people usually behave to something that's new. And we now know that this was a very important new at the time new disease that was discovered, Lyme disease from the Lyme, Connecticut, where it was first recognized. There was the first cluster of disease that was recognized. But it's all over the country. It's particularly common in Westchester, New York, for example. Lyme disease is also a very important disease, not just because it's important in its own right clinically, because it caused a whole new look at rheumatic diseases. On another lecture later on, I'll mention rheumatic fever and carditis, rheumatic arthritis in my strep lecture. I've already mentioned Reiter's syndrome in my Enterobacteriaceae lecture. These are all rheumatic diseases where an organism sets off an infection, in this case through a tick bite. You know you've got an infection, and then later on you can find no evidence that the organism is there, but the disease doesn't go away. And it's still very confusing in 2009, you know, what is going on? And it's very important, to the many patients who have arthritic diseases. Okay, so it's useful to think about Lyme disease, Reiter's syndrome, and the disease we'll see later on, rheumatic arthritis. And I did say rheumatic arthritis, and I didn't say rheumatoid arthritis. I'll stress that difference again, because rheumatoid arthritis is one of the two major rheumatic diseases that we see in this country, along with osteoarthritis. Rheumatic arthritis is almost unseen in this country nowadays. So I didn't say rheumatoid, I said rheumatic. Okay, let's talk a little bit about the etiology of Lyme disease, recognizing it's not just Lyme disease that we're talking about. There's a whole group of these things out there. Lyme disease is transmitted by a tick bite. I don't care very much about ticks. If you want to know how many legs they've got and what have you, that's fine. But that's just there to point out it's a tick bite. Okay. What we do care about is this. If you get lucky, it's characterized initially by an erythematous rash. This is a situation where people, particularly in places like South Carolina, who like to hunt, or for that matter, those who like to take their kids out into the mountains, out in the Clemson area, Asheville, whatever. The point is that you can get a tick on you and get this erythematous rash, but the point is not everybody notices that they've got a rash, particularly if it's not that big. And a lot of times we get rashes for all sorts of reasons. It could be sunburn. You know, you may not recognize that you've had a tick bite. You may not recognize the rash. So if you get this, if you do recognize you've had a tick bite, and if you do see this happen, this is great news. This is really good news, because it means that not good news that you've got Lyme disease, but it's good news that you can go ahead and make that you can treat it, because acute Lyme disease is very treatable. Chronic Lyme disease is not. So a tick bite leads to the transmission of Borrelia burgdorferi, and this was named after Willy Burgdorfer, who actually discovered the organism in collaboration, I think, with Alan Steer, who discovered the disease. Lyme disease, it starts out as a bacteremia, and the results can be, the arthritis is the thing that was most noted, but there are cardiac lesions, and there can be neurologic lesions, and they don't always go together. Sometimes you may see a strange, particularly you may see the neurological features. Sometimes it may be more cardiac. Arthritis is the most common thing and the most that people emphasize. But it can occur, the actual disease may not occur weeks to months after the original infection. And yes, we put down that there's a bacteremia, but you know, that's often an assumption rather than sort of coming from observation, because there's a small problem here. And that is that this organism can't be grown in the. It's basically never cultured from patients. Once you've actually managed to get lucky and you've actually did isolate it from a patient or from a tick, you can keep it going in tissue culture media and you can study it. But actually going ahead and documenting that somebody has a bacteremia with Lyme disease is almost impossible. But that's the assumption that we're making. So, therapy. If you can treat early on, this is the physician's conundrum. If you know you've got an acute case of Lyme disease, it's very treatable with penicillin and tetracycline. Unfortunately, if you make a late diagnosis, the antibiotics are ineffective. That's a real issue. Because the problem is that if you could, because the organism can't be grown in the laboratory, and this is the whole theme with the spirochetes, and basically going through this whole thing, is that you can't grow these organisms at all, or they're extremely difficult to grow, sufficiently so that you basically wouldn't bother in a clinical situation. So again, serology is the big deal here, just like in syphilis. One looks to see if there are antibodies developed against the organism. But as I've said already, laboratory strains, they do grow extremely slowly. You can grow them in tissue culture media, not bacteriological media. I didn't say tissue culture here, it says tissue culture media. They'll grow in very rich media, normally used to grow things like fibroblasts or macrophages or what have you. But they're in the media itself. They're like really rich media. They will grow. But it's almost never will you isolate these organisms from patients' body fluids and tissue samples, which is why it took so many years, and it's not that long ago, that this was recognized to be a new disease. The 1980s is not that long ago. So that is the physician's dilemma. But acutely, the patient responds to antibiotics, but it's too soon to look for antibodies. So how do you make a diagnosis? If it's acute disease, they haven't had a chance to develop the antibodies, so how do you really know you've got Lyme disease? On the other hand, if you wait a few months and you do there are lots of different kits out there for doing serology in Lyme disease. It's the standard way it's done. If you wait and you get antibodies, you say, great, the patient's got Lyme disease. Oh, but duh, it's too late to treat them. So that's why the disease continues to be of major interest. I'm not saying what you should do. I don't know. I don't treat patients with Lyme disease. Maybe you'll have that problem at some point. But anyway, I'm just putting out the problem. Okay, so this is a reactive arthritis, as opposed to a septic arthritis. The word sepsis, whenever we use the word sepsis, we're talking about the actual organisms being present. A septicemia would be a situation where we have organisms in the bloodstream. This is not a septic arthritis. This is a reactive arthritis in which we start off with an infection, in this case from a tick bite going through the skin. In the case of Ryder syndrome, it would be a urogenital infection. In the case of rheumatic arthritis, not rheumatoid arthritis, it would be from a pharyngeal infection with a group A streptococcus. It doesn't matter where the organism starts off the infection. The consequence is you don't find these organisms you take some fluid, some synovial fluid, joint fluid, you don't find these organisms present. That's what the word reactive means. It's a rheumatological term, reactive. Okay? And the other examples I mentioned, that's Ryder syndrome and rheumatic fever, and I won't make this big deal. I didn't make it with Ryder. There's no point saying the same thing over and over again. The etiology, what's going on, the basic concept of what's going on. And yeah, did I tell you what's going on? No, I didn't, because we don't know exactly what's going on. It could be that the organism is there in very low numbers, just sort of dormant, not growing. Could be there's been an autoimmune response. Could be there's bits and pieces of degraded bacteria hanging around forever in these people. All of these are possibilities. Nobody has the answer. Again, it resembles rheumatoid arthritis, and I mean by that histologically and clinically, but the etiology is different, because rheumatoid arthritis, as far as we know, has got nothing to do with the sorts of things that go on in these diseases. Okay. So that's the second major disease caused by spirochetes, Lyme disease, Borrelia burgdorferi. So we've covered syphilis, Treponemus pallidum. We've covered Lyme disease caused by Borrelia burgdorferi. For the sake of completeness, we should mention a couple of other things. Relapsing fever, and that word relapsing, if you really think hard about it, tells you most of what you need to know about this disease. I'll get to that in a second. There are less than 100 cases a year in the United States. Transmission is also from a tick, but it's from it's a different species of Borrelia. This is Borrelia hermsii. If it's a case of a tick, if it's a case of lice, it's another species, Borrelia recurrentis. Okay, so these are two different Borrelia. They're nothing to do with the Borrelia that cause Lyme disease. And it's a different disease, relapsing fever. Very, very few cases in the United States. But this was the traditional Borrelia disease that was known for many years, long before Lyme disease. And, you know, a lot of times you'll find in books, they'll mix together Lyme disease and relapsing fever. But the thing is, this is the minor one. The Lyme disease is the historically important one, but the Lyme disease is the important one. Why relapsing? Why are we making a big deal about the word relapsing? Okay, because what happens in this disease, an immune response develops, and as the disease develops, it relapses. The organism seems to be able to shift, just like certain other organisms, like the AIDS virus. It seems to be able to shift its antigenic repertoire. And so as you develop an antibody response, it cuts down the number of organisms, the disease goes down. As the disease goes down, the organism starts expressing new antigens on its surface, it starts growing again, the disease comes back again. So you get this ebb and flow situation in relapsing fever. Okay. Diagnosis, you know, the continuing theme we have with spirochetes, no culture. And worse than that, in this case, there's not even a serological test. And you can see why, because the antigens keep changing. So how do you come up with a test when you've got different antigens in different strains in different circumstances? So there's no serological test for this. It's generally detected by blood smear. But again, you can imagine how good that is. I've talked about you in the past, you know, about in other lectures about looking at microscopy. The human eye is only so good. Okay? So it's not an easy thing to do. Okay? Diagnosis is not an easy, laboratory-based diagnosis here is not an easy thing to do. And there are very few people around the country who know anything about this disease. Okay, so that was the Borrelia, the second genus among the spirochetes that we've been talking about. Now we're talking about leptospirosis. And again, you see this in typical spiral-shaped organisms. This is another electron micrograph. These typical long spiral organisms, as opposed to what I showed you when I showed you the Campylobacter, when I showed you the Helicobacter, yeah, they're spiral, but there's no way you could confuse something like that with something that's basically a rod with a couple of twists in it. Okay? So that's why these are quite different, the spirochetes. Leptospirosis, again, less than 100 cases a year in the US. The symptoms are flu-like. It can be a severe systemic disease, and I've underlined the kidney, because with this disease, what we think about is urine and kidney. That's basically what we think about a lot in this disease. Why? This organism seems to reside very well in the kidney, in both, it's a zoonotic infection, in both the organisms where it originally lives, the source, and in the people that get infected. If a rodent or a farm animal sufficient amount of urination occurs in a sort of local water supply, and the organisms get into the water, somebody bathing in the water, the organism can get the organism through a small lesion or cut or whatever in their skin. So that's how the organism is transmitted. And again, it ends up, the kidney is the big deal here. So that's the whole big thing with leptospirosis. Again, less than 100 cases a year in the US. And serology, again, is the big deal. It is considered the most readily culturable of the spirochetes. But, you know, nothing versus 1% is still basically nothing. You know, yes, they are the most readily culturable. That is an accurate statement. But they still don't grow very well. So serology is used in this disease, in this case, for laboratory-based diagnosis as well. Okay? So that's the statement you do need to remember, but don't get confused and say, it's really easy to culture these things. There's no such thing as an easily culturable spirochete that causes human disease. Okay, that was the spirochetes, Treponema, Borrelia, Leptospira, three different genera, all spiral-shaped organisms. And we covered two major diseases there, syphilis and Lyme disease, and two minor things we covered, relapsing fever and leptospirosis. Okay, now as I said right at the beginning of the lecture, we are going to, particularly, we are covering here the two organisms that cause, three most important organisms that cause sexually transmitted diseases. There are probably 10 times the number of cases of gonorrhea each year as there is our syphilis. And yes, it's still with us, and yes, we see there's a lot of it. There's probably millions of new cases of gonorrhea each year. This organism is a diplococcus, but it's a gram-negative diplococcus, as opposed to when we deal with the pneumococcus, which is a gram-positive diplococcus. Diplococcus means that the organism under the microscope, that the individual cells don't seem to quite separate each from each other very well when they're dividing. You can see here this pair of cells is trying to get away from each other. It's trying to grow away from each other and divide, but it's very common that you see them as in this way. That's referred to as diplococci. It's a generic term, rather like the way we use the word bacillus. However, the organ is sufficiently important that we refer to it as its own name. It's referred to as the gonococcus. Okay, so the word diplococcus is a general term for organisms that grow in this way. But this organism is sufficiently important, being still one of the major human organisms that causes human disease. It has its own special name, the gonococcus. Okay? And this would be an example. I didn't have a slide earlier on. I told you if you used a fluorescent antibody to stain, I said in syphilis, but here is an example of this organism has been stained with a fluorescent antibody. And that's what it would look like under a fluorescent microscope. Okay? So that's just an example of that situation. Okay, so Neisseria, and it doesn't matter if I'm talking about, I'm going to talk about two different organisms here. Neisseria gonorrhoeae, the causative agent of gonorrhea, the gonococcus, and I'm going to be talking, which is the, because chlamydia is considered the number one cause of sexually transmitted diseases in this country at the moment. The gonococcus is considered number two, syphilis is considered number three. Neisseria includes not just gonorrhea, one of the major the organisms that causes gonorrhea. It also includes Neisseria meningitidis, which is the second leading cause of meningitis. Now, there aren't many cases of meningitis, relatively speaking, in the US. But the point is that if somebody gets a case of syphilis or gonorrhea, you've got quite a long time before you can deal with it. If somebody gets a case of meningitis, they could basically be dead within a couple of days, or they could have severe brain injury. So numbers don't come into it when you're talking about meningitis. That's why I think, you know better than I do because you're students in this place, but I believe that students at USC are required to be vaccinated against Neisseria meningitidis. I think you've all had that vaccine. It's not that it's that common. It's just that it's a really nasty disease, meningitis. Okay, so Neisseria. Are gram-negative. It doesn't matter if I'm talking about Neisseria gonorrhoeae or if I'm talking about Neisseria meningitidis. They're diplococci, pairs of cocci. They are oxidized positive. These organisms aren't the best growing organisms in the world, but they can be grown in culture. And a particular medium that's used is Thayer Martin agar. I haven't used this term before, and I should stress it. There are two different types of agars that are used in the laboratory. One is sort of non-selective, which means basically just about anything will grow on it. And selective means that you've put things in the agar to try and encourage this organism to grow and other things to not. And you have to do that in this case because this is not an organism that grows very well. So what's used is what's called chocolate agar. Usually we use things like sheep blood agar, which of course is red. In this case, the blood is cooked basically before the agar is made, and it becomes chocolate in color. That's why it's called chocolate agar. Heated blood basically. And there are antibiotics added to the formulations that this organism does quite well with, but others don't. And that's what we mean by selective. So we're trying to inhibit stuff that in blood these organisms just don't grow very well on regular sheep blood agar. So the blood's being heated before this agar's made to make it easier for them to grow, and it's selective because there are other things added to the media that this organism can grow in and other organisms don't. Okay, so that's what we mean by selective. Neisseria gonorrhoeae, and as I said, it's particularly important enough that it's called the gonococcus. You don't see too many cases when an organism's got its own name. It's like having a wanted poster out there or something, you know. Neisseria gonorrhoeae, the gonococcus, found only in man. The causative agent of gonorrhea, second most common venereal disease, as I already said. And you can't, if you get lucky and you see this, yeah, you can't confuse this with syphilis. Because what happens in this disease is you get this nasty exudate of pus, basically. We're not looking at somebody having an ejaculation there. That's pus. Okay? All right. So that, and of course, if that was sitting, in a female, you might not see it. And that's why people talk a lot about the difficulty of making diagnosis in females for anatomical reasons versus making a diagnosis in a male. And of course, not every case of gonorrhea, you're going to get such a nasty exudate. Okay? But if you do see something like that, I mean, you know what you've got. Okay. I don't want to see something like that, personally. Okay. So you can do a smear, and what we're looking at there is pus, polymorphonuclear cells. When they were oftentimes, the gram-negative cocci will be inside the cells. Some of them may not have been taken up. So we'll see it's referred to as gram-negative diplococci, some of which are intracellular and some of which are extracellular. That's what you'll see under the microscope. Okay. And yes, it does disseminate from the local site. And one of the things septic arthritis is, that's an example there. I used the word reactive earlier. Now I'm using the word septic. This is a septic arthritis. And does it make a difference? Absolutely. If you're in a rheumatology clinic, you almost never see a case of gonorrhea. You would say the most common thing that you're going to see in terms of septic arthritis would be staphylococcal arthritis mediated by Staph aureus or Staphylococcus epidermidis. If you're in a sexual disease clinic, you're never going to see a case of septic arthritis caused by a staphylococcus. What you're going to see is septic arthritis caused by a gonococcus. So your perspective changes, depends on what type of physician you are. But anyway, the most common septic arthritis is caused by Staphylococcus aureus, with the exception if you happen to be in, a sexual disease clinic. Okay? All right. So that's the situation there. This is a very common in that situation form of septic arthritis. Dermatitis is also very common. Antibiotic therapy. It just seems that this particular organism has become quite resistant because of a beta-lactamase, and ceftriaxone is the antibiotic that's particularly used in this disease. The main thing I want to point out is the fact that a lot of these organisms are resistant to most of the penicillins and many of the cephalosporins. This is the main issue. They produce a beta-lactamase, which destroys, among other things, penicillin G, the classical penicillin. Okay. There aren't exotoxins, really, much that people think about in this disease. That makes life a bit easier in talking about its pathogenesis. So, yes, people talk a lot about things like the lipopolysaccharides and the peptidoglycans, but that will probably refer to just about any bacterial infection. Things that are considered important are the fact that there are outer membrane proteins and pili which seem to be involved in adhesion. And there have been efforts to develop a vaccine. The military, some years ago, spent a lot of money trying to develop a vaccine. But there's so many variants of these outer membrane proteins and pili that it's been very difficult to develop a vaccine. And since it is very treatable, and it isn't really life-threatening because it's it will be treated long before the point it would reach that stage. There hasn't been a lot of emphasis on a vaccine being developed in this case. But, you know, times could change. If we could spend a few $1 billion on developing a new version of an anthrax vaccine, when we had six people died in this country, you know, it might not be a bad idea to have a vaccine for, you know, a situation where there are millions of people getting the disease a year. But, you know, I don't make decisions. I'm not part of the government, you know. But anyway, be that as it may. So there probably is a need for the vaccine of this type, but we don't have one. And it's an organism that makes an IgA protease, because it's an organism that starts off its infection on surfaces, and so being able to deal with IgA, you know, in that sort of pus that I just talked about, is a protection mechanism. It also refers to Neisseria meningitidis as well. Okay, and as I said just now, you know, there's a lot of discussion about lipopolysaccharides and peptidoglycans being involved in the tissue injury in this disease. I suppose, you know, and there has been a fair bit of research done on it as well. But, you know, that any time you've got a gram-negative infection and you don't have exotoxins, it really shouldn't be a big shock that the lipopolysaccharides and or peptidoglycans might be involved in the tissue injury, right? Okay. Neisseria meningitidis. Now, again, it's an organ, and again, my spelling is getting worse, I tell you. I just noticed there's an O missing. Okay. The meningococcus. Is that one actually spelled properly? Okay, that was actually spelled right. Got it right that time. Okay. The meningococcus. Sufficiently important that it has its own name again. And that is the second most common cause of meningitis. That doesn't mean it's common. There are very few cases of meningitis in this country. The problem is, as I say, when you do get a case of meningitis, that's a very, very, that's really bad news. It resides in man only, and usually there are sporadic cases. You know, just a child here or a child there. It's sporadic, but that's not why you've all been vaccinated. It's because of the fact that what happens is, and it doesn't happen very often, but when it does happen, it's really bad news. What happens is when you get people living in close quarters, particularly on like military barracks, the army tends to vaccinate people against this organism. When you've got people living in dorm rooms, I know with medical students, you know, some of you may be a bit older, a bit married, whatever, you may not be living in dorms, but certainly undergraduates living in dorm rooms. You know, that they're close quarters. If there's a case of meningitis, it can very easily spread rapidly to others. So it's not that you often see these outbreaks, but when you do see an outbreak, as I say, it's really bad news. So that's what I mean by crowded conditions, particularly the army barracks and dorms. These are the sorts of places that you see these occasional outbreaks of, and I didn't say epidemics or pandemics, these occasional outbreaks of meningitis. Neisseria meningitidis lives in the upper respiratory tract of people. A lot of times it's not doing very much. But for whatever reason, the organism changes a little bit. You change a little bit. Maybe you've had, you know, maybe whatever reason, you're a bit immunocompromised, you're a bit sick that day, whatever the reasons are. Sometimes the organism actually does get from the upper respiratory tract into the bloodstream. And from the bloodstream, that's a bacteremia, and that's bad enough. But unfortunately, there's certainly organisms, and this is the number two among them, that have a tropism for getting past the blood-brain barrier and getting into the brain. And this is one of them. And that's when we see a meningitis. So that's Neisseria meningitidis. And we'll talk about Streptococcus pneumoniae later on. And the other one that falls into this group is Haemophilus influenzae that my wife will cover. So meningococcal meningitis, okay, it's got its own name because it's that important. The second most common meningitis, the pneumococcus, is the most common, and it's fatal often if untreated. Fortunately, it does respond well to antibiotic therapy, including penicillin. Laboratory diagnosis, and this is exactly if you got it for the Neisseria gonorrhoeae, you got it for Neisseria meningitidis, okay? It's the same idea. Gram-negative diplococci, except this case we're not talking about looking in some fluid from a some pus from a penis. We're talking about here spinal fluid. This is a brain infection. So you'll be taking a sample of spinal fluid and you look again for diplococci in white blood cells. Same thing, just a different place. And that's Neisseria meningitidis. Over the years, people have tried to look for meningococcal antigens, and this has probably faded away. It's never been very successful. And again, for that matter, it isn't, you know, if you see these gram-negative diplococci in the spinal fluid, that's fantastic. But you may only see it in 30 to 50%, depending how good you are, of the time. So it's great if you can get if you suspect somebody's got meningitis, it's really nice to be able to make a very quick diagnosis. But if you do this and you foul, that doesn't mean the person doesn't have meningitis. You do carry out culture, and yes, you may not oftentimes you will go ahead and treat. You won't wait for the culture results. You sure don't want a dead person on your hands. But it's nice to have that warm, fuzzy feeling, and maybe also you might have picked the wrong antibiotic to actually get a result and know that you've actually made a diagnosis, not just that you think you knew what was going on, but you actually know what is going on. So you're not going to do culture to aid initial treatment. You're going to do culture to confirm what you're already doing, okay? Because you're not going to wait 24 to 48 hours to treat somebody to wait for a culture result. That would be ridiculous. Okay, so what about pathogenesis factors and the meningococcus? Well, here we get lucky, or unlucky, depending on how you want to look at it. The capsule is the major pathogenesis factor in diseases caused by the meningococcus, and the capsule, like any other capsule, stops phagocytosis. Fortunately, anti-capsular antibodies stop infection. That's the good news. The bad news is there's a lot of antigenic variation. There are dozens of different antigens that can be expressed on different strains of the pneumococcus. And I'm not going to give you an exact number because it changes from year to year, country to country. But what is important is we do have a vaccine. We have an effective vaccine, and the vaccine has to be recognized multiple serogroups because there's such variation in the antigens that are expressed on the surface of these organisms. But there is a good vaccine. Okay, so you got lucky. I got lucky. We finished a few minutes early. Okay, hopefully I covered all the material anyway. Okay, thank you very much. I'll wait around again for a minute. If anybody's got any questions, I'll be happy to stick around for a few minutes or longer if need be.